My dear Matisse, I have some very sad news for you. After a month's illness, my poor Mart died of a heart attack. 6 days ago, we buried her in Le Canet Cemetery. You can imagine my grief and my solitude, filled with bitterness and worry about the life I may lead from now on. Bonnard.
After 49 years, artist Pierre Bonnard lost his wife, Marthe. She had been his model, the inspiration for his greatest paintings. His obsession with Marthe resulted in a body of work which has established him as one of the world's great masters of color and light. From their first encounters in Paris to their quiet life in the country, Bonnard observed his sole companion dressing, eating, sleeping.
It's a love story, an everlasting love story from 1893 until she died, 1942.
She's an extremely intriguing figure, Mark. I mean, she is right at the heart of his work. They were sort of conducting an artistic experiment, the two of them together, for a very long period, untouched by the outside world in general. And the fact that you never get to know her somehow suggests that also Bonnard was continually trying to get to know her and never quite managed it.
Even after Marthe died, Bonnard continued to be obsessed and fascinated by her presence. There is an incredibly moving, melancholic feeling to so many of those very, very late works. The sumptuous, rich, decorative quality is completely compelling.
But the beauty of these paintings also tells a darker story. Each picture offers an even closer glimpse into the life of a man haunted by memory.
It's almost like a dead body, in a way. So it's not clear whether he's given up or whether he's in some kind of identification with her as dead. You feel like they're reminders of her, and it's almost like he's putting a bit of her in the foreground and himself in the background in the mirror and working out, well, what is the connection between these things and him? It feels to me as if, and this is entirely speculation, that it's only when she dies that he realizes what an impoverished life he's been living with her. What was this woman for? What was he using her for? What kind of relationship was this?
Pierre Bonnard was born in a suburb of Paris, the son of a high-ranking civil servant. As part of the expanding bourgeoisie, Bonnard was expected to follow in his father's footsteps. He was sent away to boarding school as a boy and steered towards law as a young man. But Bonnard upset the grand plan in 1888 when he failed his civil service exams. He decided instead to study art.
It seems to me very much a young man's picture. It has a kind of intent, slightly defiant quality. Almost as though he's daring us to challenge him about whether he's going to be an artist. And the paintbrushes could almost be a quiver of arrows. I'm this bourgeois lawyer, professional person, but in fact I'm an artist. And I think that's the dare, that's the challenge of the picture.
At that time, I had not quite realized that I wanted to be a painter. I think that what attracted me was less the art itself than the artistic life, with all that I thought it meant. A free imagination and freedom to live as one pleased. Above all, I wanted to escape from a monotonous existence.
In his case, it meant informality and freedom from this essentially starchy conventional society that he grew up in, which he did manage to avoid. We shouldn't think of Bonnard as a settled bourgeois artist at all. He's someone who's constantly on the move, constantly in flight from any kind of settled life. Bonnard's Paris was Montmartre, which was always seen as the free city of Montmartre. It was seen as somewhere apart from right bank, which was money, or the left bank, which was the Sorbonne and the world of intellect. And just at the moment that he arrived there, it becomes the focus of a new political creed, which is anarchism. And Bonnard becomes drawn into the circle of friends who are really very active in anarchism.
Like many artists in the city, Bonnard was disenchanted with the fast growth of science and materialism, and anarchism offered a different vision of the future. With journals like La Revue Blanche acting as a forum for these ideas, Bonnard's posters and illustrations for the magazine launched his career. Together with his friends Serrouzier, Denis and Vuillard, Bonnard joined a group of artists known as the Nabi. Seduced by the intense color and line in the work of Gauguin and Cézanne, the Nabi abandoned traditional values of painting and looked towards a more popular and decorative art for the everyday. Bonnard was also fascinated by Japanese art, which was all the rage in Paris. The flat designs and strong lines he adopted from these Oriental prints earned him the nickname the Japanese Nabi, and formed the style that will be made famous by his risque poster for France Champagne. With work displayed on every street corner, praise from Renoir, and a growing influence on Toulouse-Lautrec, Bonnard was the name on everyone's lips. He was still in his 20s. It was at this time that he met the young woman who would change his life. She made silk flowers for funeral cortège and went by the name of Marthe de Méligny.
He met her in Montmartre, maybe in the flower shop where she was working. And she was in Paris since some years by herself, working, because she left her family in the countryside, young for that period. She was 22 or something like that when she moved to Paris, and she was 24 when she met Bonnard, and he was 26. I think that at that time in 1900 she had no contact with her parents, and her parents did not know that she was with a painter anyway. They never knew. The two families were never introduced, because she was too shy, she was too simple, and she was surrounded by people of what she considered high-class society, and she was from the milieu of craftsmen. At the beginning, it was a very strong love for both of them, and you can see that in some paintings where the sensuality is not only sensuality but love, the flesh of the body. You can feel the flesh of the body. Of
course, it was quite typical for male artists to paint working-class women as their models, and indeed to sleep with them. It would have been, you know, par for the course that male artists would have slept with those very models and treated them in ways that would have been entirely different from the women of their own class. The fact that she was to become his lifelong companion was what makes his case somewhat different from many other artists. And I think that because of that, they lived a very separate and very reclusive life. And she, in a sense, came to be the embodiment of a fantasy of femininity for Bonnard.
You can identify a lot of the drawings and paintings from these photographs. The privacy of them, or the sense of privacy that's in them, is really what makes them erotic, because you feel that these are experiences that the painter has just been through or is about to go through. The sensuality of the pictures is really something quite striking, I think. You don't see people's faces, you see bodies, you see glimpses, you see suggestions. Everything is somehow veiled in a rather interesting way. There was a lot of interest in a kind of adolescent sexuality at the time, but I think that matured into something more interesting in Bonnard, which was to do with the monogamous bond, I suppose, between him and Mal. But it could well be that the longer you live with somebody in close proximity, the more stark the distances between you seem to be. So that in a sense, the result of continued intimacy might be even more bewilderment about the other. And that early painting of the enormous distance between two people who know each other very well and have just made love somehow, you know, kind of arches across the whole range of his work, I think.
The paintings speak to the kind of anxiety that late 20th century subjects have. We're not confident about who we are and what our role in the world is and what our identities are as men or women. And I think that that discomfort is something that's articulated by the weird angled vision that Bonnard captures. So in a weird way, I think his time has come.
I am of no school. I am only looking to do something personal. It's not a matter of painting life. It's a matter of giving life to painting.
One ritual which certainly one shouldn't underestimate right through his life is that he always took a morning walk. And obviously, at first, that was through the streets of Montmartre. He was looking for a moment of grace to appear to him. I think there was a sense of his watching from a distance, often, the street. There's this sense of him standing still and the world moving. He uses memory, he actually works in a different way to most painters. What he's really trying to do is relive a moment. One of his definitions is that painting is a stilling of time. There is this sense in all the greatest Bonnards of a moment held and relived, and in that moment one both loses oneself and one finds oneself. One loses oneself to the world. You suddenly see the world in a new way, but you also find yourself in a way that is right outside the usual habits of seeing and habits of living a life.
I am thinking of my painting, and it is only just beginning to organize itself in my mind. The whole thing must mature like an apple. You cannot force the pace of time.
Everything seemed to be going for Bonnard when he began to leave Paris for longer and longer periods each year to work like an archetypal impressionist painter in the Seine Valley. And that, for a young painter in retrospect, was an extremely dangerous thing to have done.
Bonnard's transformation from bohemian artist to a bourgeois impressionist was a surprise to the art world. He was drawn to Giverny and into Monet's garden, a move that was to earn Bonnard the label of old-fashioned. Outside of Monet's garden, times had changed. War had started. The great experiments of modernism had begun. But Bonnard felt there was more to learn from the father of Impressionism.
We have this picture of Monet as an older statesman, the venerable patriarch with a beard, who'd managed to, as it were, single-handedly reinvent the whole French landscape tradition. The water lily pond provided Monet with his subject matter for the last 26 years of his life. He excluded the outside world, created his own internal paradise.
Monet painted tiny shifts of light on a monumental scale. His practice of returning again and again to the same places in his garden for inspiration greatly appealed to Bonnard. The lure of the northern countryside, the light, and the thriving impressionist community surrounding Monet led Bonnard to buy a house there in 1913. Marroulotte became a country home for Bonnard and Marthe, where he could record the same scenes at different moments, capturing them on huge canvases, overlooking his own modest paradise.
How small everything is. How intimate. Instead of being grand like Monet's house, a house full of dependents, Bonnard's house is a kind of weekend retreat of a petit bourgeois. And it is so interesting the way that that little terrace at Marroulotte became the stage for different performances overlooking this great theatre of nature. Where instead of looking at a landscape, we're actually drawn into the landscape and look around us and discover figures cropping up on the periphery of vision.
My friends and I wanted to pick up the work of the Impressionists and push it further. We wanted to outshine them in their naturalistic impressions of color. Art is not nature. There was a lot more to be got out of color as a means of expression.
he would combine quite curiously figures from his immediate entourage, of course presided over by Marthe, but Marthe sometimes would take on the aspect of a classical goddess. She would have that sort of posed immobility, and she would carry perhaps an apple. It's very, very difficult to say what specifically the figures represent. They seem to have run out of the antique gallery of the Louvre, picking up, as it were, a rejected tennis racket. And their intrusion on the scene is a very strange amalgam of the past with the contemporary. It's very unlikely that these great terrace paintings actually record an incident. Maybe they were sparked off by incidents that had caught his eye, perhaps over several years.
He paints the moment very, very, very successfully, but he also paints the bigger moment, there's a bigger idea, the bigger picture, but there's also a tiny wee picture and hundreds of moments all together. They kind of keep you guessing, you know, they're like riddles, they keep you guessing and you never get bored with them. The paintings that I really like are the inside-outside ones, the ones where we've got the views and we've got the interiors, we've got the table, we've got the bowl of fruit on the table. Tremendous compositional devices. And then, oops, you've got a figure, you're not quite sure if that figure's right, if it's not working, or is it turning round, is it moving back? And the inside and the outside, literally, but also psychologically. And the heaviness, you know, the ennui, the heaviness of the French afternoon. There's interminable afternoons spent behind shuttered windows. And then, wham, the shutters are opened. You get a glimpse of a garden, glimpse of an almond tree. Fantastic stuff. And then another horizon away behind.
The shores of the French Riviera had an increasing attraction for Bonnard. Frequent trips to Cannes had brought vibrant colour to his work, making his paintings even more popular with dealers and unpopular with critics. The bright skies and warm climate of the south also suited Marthe, who was subject to chest complaints and ill health.
She was born with a strong asthma in her childhood. Also that we know because of the correspondence with her sister. And she had that asthma all her own life. I don't know why they did not have children. Maybe there was not space enough for children, because Bonnard was not a non-stop worker. He worked a lot, and maybe he had enough, or maybe she could not have children. Nobody knows about that subject. What I can say that Marthe was missing children.
Marthe a été son principal modèle, mais elle n'a pas été son unique modèle. De la même façon, on a dit que Marthe avait accompagné Bonnard toute sa vie, ce qui est vrai. Ils faisaient corps tous les deux. Mais Marthe n'a pas été son seul amour. Bonnard a connu d'autres femmes. Mais comme il était lui-même extrêmement discret, extrêmement pudique sur lui-même, les amis autour de lui, les quelques amis qu'il avait très proches de lui, observaient avec lui la même discrétion que Bonnard mettait à lui-même. Et notamment, il a aimé une jeune femme, Renée, qui avait, je crois, une trentaine d'années, était d'une trentaine d'années plus jeune, et il l'a profondément aimée, et elle-même avait une passion pour Bonnard.
it's almost like he's in a furnace of some sort, that the daubs of paint are like flames. It's extremely powerful physical presence. It's almost like he's looking for something in his face that he can only find in the background of the picture. It's as though that's like a picture of his thoughts in some way, or feelings.
I think there's this confessional side to Bonnard that's been understated. A lot of Bonnards have a theme that amounts to telling you something about his inner life, his personal life. There are pictures like Young Women in the Garden. You have René Monchanté's face smiling up at you, and there is a still life with fruit and a wonderful sense of the garden. And then you suddenly see, cornered, this very unsmiling profile of Marthe. And you think, oh my God, you know this. And between them is this strange construction that I think is actually a piece of garden furniture, but it could really be an instrument of torture or something between them. And you feel Bonnard making this choice between two women.
In 1921, Bonnard went to Rome with René Monchanté to ask for her hand in marriage. A few weeks later, the engagement was broken off, and Bonnard returned to Marthe, who was unwell. René is said to have checked into a Paris hotel, laid down in a bed of white lilies, and shot herself through the head. Marthe is said to have destroyed every painting of René she could find.
Bonnard, malheureusement, a sacrifié cette jeune femme, non pas à Marthe même, mais à sa peinture. Tout ce qui s'interposait entre sa peinture et lui, et entre Marthe, qui représentait, qui était sa chose picturale, si j'ose dire, il l'a sacrifiée. Et il a été très malheureux lorsque René s'est suicidé. Il en a été malheureux le reste de ses jours. Et curieusement, les tableaux nocturnes de Bonnard ont augmenté après la mort de René. Et il s'est servi de la détresse de Marthe pour peindre sa propre douleur après la mort de René.
I don't spend much more than 2 months in the year in Paris. I can't work there. Too much noise, too many distractions. I know that many painters get used to that in life. For myself, it was always difficult.
He could say to Marthe, go away. I mean, he had the possibility to get rid of her. He did not do that. Why? Because he beloved her. In a soirée, somebody said that Marthe was not the kind of lady you can marry. So the day after, he married her.
On a hot August day, Bonnard took Marthe to the altar. Their families were not informed. Their concierge and her husband were the only witnesses when, during the marriage ceremony, Bonnard found out the real name of the woman he'd been with for 32 years. Marthe de Méligny had been an invention.
Bonnard found out the real name of Marthe the day he married her. Marthe had a maiden name, Boursa, very simple. And she invented another name, and she made that name just not to be too simple in front of Bonnard's milieu. I think the whole story is a question of two different milieu.
Bonnard and Marthe seemed more and more at ease in the warmer climate of the south of France. There, Marthe would be well for a time, and Bonnard could find fresh inspiration. In 1926, they decided to settle permanently on a hill above Cannes. Le Bosquet would become their final residence, a refuge in the hills where the couple could spin out their days in a ritual which Bonnard would record on canvas. The house was far away from the political unrest of the 1930s and the scathing art world of Paris. Bonnard continued to go his own way, but it was a practice that inflamed his critics, including Picasso.
Don't talk to me about Bonnard. That's not painting, what he does. When Bonnard paints the sky, perhaps he paints it blue, more or less the way it looks. Then he looks a little longer and sees some mauve in it, so he adds a touch or two of mauve. The result is a potpourri of indecision. Painting can't be done that way.
I think in a way he's not as mega as he should have been. I don't know why that is, possibly the Picasso thing. In a way, Picasso stole his thunder, because Picasso was more of a showman and a big PR guy. And Bonnard was not like that. He just had his ritual. He got up in the morning, had a light breakfast, went out with his wee dog at the end of a piece of string and his bonnet on, and then and did lots of drawings and then came back. And he also paints about the French way of life. And I can see why people think he was old-fashioned, but he's not an old-fashioned painter, because his paintings still stand the test of time. They're terribly contemporary. I mean, they're quite abstract. I first saw Bonnard's work when I was an art student, and I just became completely immersed in them, totally pulled into them, mesmerized by them. I mean, it was like looking at, rolling around inside an Indian carpet. They're so rich and full of different things and shapes, and oh, they're just absolutely jam-packed with rich, heavy, sensuous color and shapes and ideas and people and plants, and there's no focal point. And what's astonishing about them is there really is no focal point. But they kind of stop you. You look at them and you're just completely transported into another plane.
Cette maison était le plus simple du monde, et que toutes les maisons que Bonnard a habitées étaient toujours aussi simples, mais toujours joliment situées. Au Canet, il avait choisi cette maison, tellement simple, mais parce qu'il avait la vue au-dessus de Cannes, sur la mer, sur les montagnes. Toutes ces maisons, comme celles de son enfance, avaient un balcon et des portes-fenêtres.
Our God is light. A day will come when you will understand what that means.
La première fois que je suis venu ici, j'avais 14 ans. Et Bonnard lui-même, quand je suis rentré dans ce petit jardin, est descendu et a ouvert la porte lui-même. Il était l'homme le plus simple qu'on puisse imaginer, et il ressemblait à un personnage de ses tableaux. Il avait 75 ans à ce moment, et là j'étais très surpris. Je pensais voir des tableaux, et j'ai vu des toiles retourner sur elles-mêmes. Parce que Bonnard ne peignait jamais sur ses tableaux directement sur châssis, il punaisait ses tableaux sur le mur. Alors quand j'étais dans les jours suivants, j'étais seul avec lui dans son atelier, je le regardais peindre et j'étais évidemment très intimidé. Alors, il, tout d'un coup, il a posé ses pinceaux et m'a dit, allez Michel, nous allons boxer. C'était pour détendre l'atmosphère, pour...
The painting called The Window is one of the first paintings that he does when he's made this decision to move south. By moving south, he's lost his links with Paris, with a lot of his friends. He's cooping himself up with Marthe. And I think that there is a kind of buried narrative in that picture. And he's really giving us a kind of message from prison. Right in the foreground, there's this large book with Marie written on it. This Danish novel about an upper-class man who has an affair with a lower-class girl, leaves her, but only returns to her when she becomes very ill. And I think it's as simple as that. I think he's literally reliving that story.
Elle a été malade à peu près 20 ans avant sa mort en 1942. Elle était neurasthénique et elle ne voulait voir personne. Alors elle a beaucoup isolé Bonnard parce qu'elle était atteinte de ce que l'on pourrait appeler une sorte de manie de la persécution. Elle demandait à Bonnard de la cacher un peu. Elle se cachait derrière une ombrelle pour descendre l'escalier et elle ne voulait voir personne. Elle l'isolait du monde, elle l'a isolé du monde. Mais il a supporté cette maladie avec beaucoup de patience.
It's almost like somebody practicing what it would be like to try out a bit of boxing. And you do get the sense that there's some kind of inner torment here that can't actually be performed. It's like a failed bit of theatre, this. It's almost as though he's showing himself how puny he feels. But he's trying out what it would be like to get really furious. I think in a way this is like a bolder attempt to be a bit tough looking. But it's a very unconvincing performance again. I think Bonnard's very interested in trying to catch people in moments in a kind of twilight zone between self-absorption and actually looking out at the world. So they're very remote, these figures, in a way, but they're very, very close up. I think one of the things the paintings are saying, though, is that you never return to the same scene, that the same is always slightly different. It's like looking in the mirror. And in a way, he's looking for the movement. It appears to be the same, but it's different. And it's almost like the way in which children look at their mother's faces to judge their moods. You feel like he looks at Marthe, his wife, or he looks at a certain scene, and all the time he's watching it for the change of mood. It seems to be the same face, the same scene, but of course it's always different minute to minute.
By the time he's painting the last Bath painting, she's in her 70s. And of course, she isn't in her 70s. She's still a young woman in the picture. So there's some way in which he is holding on to a kind of eternal love and keeping her embalmed. He's speaking for the weak. And it makes for a sort of tentativeness in the whole treatment of touch and light and space, which is different, I think, to anyone who's ever painted before. I think that everyone who sees, especially the Bonnard self-portraits, senses that in some ways it's a very tragic story, and Marthe herself clearly became a tragic figure. But I do also think that there's an enormous sense of grace, of moments of grace, of moments of tenderness, which don't become any less so. I don't think he becomes any any less tender towards Marthe in the late work. On the contrary.
After years of poor health, Marthe died at home in 1942. Bonnard closed her bedroom door, leaving her room untouched. Many of his remaining friends and family felt that Marthe's death was a blessed release for Bonnard, who had nursed her through years of ill health and mental illness. At the end, one of their friends commented, "Marthe could hardly bear herself anymore."
There were many lies about their life because they did not go out too much. And people thought that Marthe was keeping Bonnard at home, which is not right. He was never happy when he was not with her. And we know that she was not happy when she was not with him.
His wife died, Marthe died. So he was very, very alone. Bonnard was somebody very quiet. He has not so many friends in south of France because it was a war and most of his friends stay in Paris. Matisse was his friend, but Matisse lived in Nice until 1943. I have a small film. When you see Bonnard, you see everybody joking, speaking, and Bonnard, we do not see him. You do not see him speaking. He was very somebody, very secret. And it's the reason why I'm very so happy to have known Bonnard, because he speak to me very much. I cannot say today what he said, because it's so long time. But what I can say, he helped me very much in the way of I begin my life of young man.
The days pass too quickly. In the mornings, I work, and in the afternoons, I go down into Cannes. This is how I spend my time. I am very interested in the landscape, and my walks are filled with reflections on this subject. I am beginning to understand this countryside, and I no longer try to find in it what is not there.
Revenions d'une promenade comme ça un matin, il s'est tourné vers la mer et il s'est frotté les mains et il s'est dit ce matin je suis content parce que je retrouve une certaine qualité d'air et de lumière que j'avais trouvé il y a 10 ans à Trouville. Je n'ai jamais vu un peintre autant préoccupé de regarder, de ne rien manquer, non seulement de ce qu'il voyait, mais de ce qu'il ressentait. Il pensait que les couleurs changeaient même selon la température. Ces couleurs extraordinaires qu'on retrouve dans ces tableaux, ils sont le fait d'une extraordinaire acuité de vision.
This is a much more serene portrait. It doesn't seem to me to have this stark feeling of isolation. It seems to be much more about solitariness. There's a kind of suggestion here of a Tibetan monk. And so this has a very powerful contemplative feeling about it, as in, it looks as though he is staring at something that is not himself, and that it's more like a meditation than a blankness. It seems to me altogether a fuller picture. I think Bonnard's real subject is solitariness and the solitude of the imagination.
Je viens de fermer ma fenêtre, le brouillard qui tombe est glacé. Jusque dans ma chambre, il pénètre, notre chambre j'aimeur le passé. Je suis seule ce soir avec mes rêves. Je suis seule ce soir sans ton amour. Le jour tombe, ma joie s'achève, tout se brise dans mon cœur lourd. Je suis seule ce soir.
It's just a very quiet little grave. It's very ordinary. He was a very ordinary man, I think, in many ways. That's what he was. But he made these extraordinary paintings, and it's us that see him as extraordinary because he produced these pictures. But I suppose he doesn't have to be extraordinary. It's what he produces. I accept that people are fascinated by his relationship with Mart and how close they were, how not close they were, all that stuff. But I mean, as he's not here to speak, we don't really know. I don't really care who the paintings are about, because I think they go beyond that. They go beyond the image. They're about women. They're about all of us, in a sense. That's why they're great pictures.
C'est quand même moi qui ai fait l'inventaire de l'atelier de Bonnard. J'ai vu tous les tableaux de Bonnard qui étaient dans son atelier, donc je peux dire que je suis une des personnes encore vivantes qui a vu pratiquement le plus de Bonnard. Chaque fois, je suis ému. Au bout de quelques minutes, je suis tellement ému que je suis impressionné comme quand j'avais 18 ans ou 19 ans, que je commençais à comprendre l'art contemporain. Et je crois que les jeunes artistes, c'est ce qu'ils vont ressentir et qu'ils commencent à ressentir maintenant. Je crois que Bonnard a fait la jointure entre le 19e et le 20e siècle, mais surtout va apporter beaucoup au 21e siècle.
À la fin de sa vie, Bonnard a dit « Je souhaite arriver en l'an 2000, je souhaite pour les jeunes gens que mon œuvre arrive en l'an 2000 avec des ailes de papillon. »